Just suppose that God searched through heaven and couldn't find one willing to be the supreme sacrifice that was needed. Oh, that could buy eternal life for you and me. Had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary, and had it not been for the old rugged cross, and had it not been for this man, his name is Jesus. Oh, then forever my soul. So glad that he was willing to drink his bitter cup. Although he prayed, Father, let it pass from me. Oh, and I'm so glad he never called heaven's angels. Had it not been for the old rugged cross, and had it not been for this man, his name is Jesus. Oh, then forever my soul.
This stall, I'm going to be in Genesis chapter number 5, and I know in this text is known as a genealogy, and I'm well aware of that, but I want to start off by thinking about this as we begin to start reading in a moment in verses 21 through 24, that here in this text there's 10 men that spoke of, and I want to say this to you, that you got to understand the principle that right now, the here and the now that you and I are living in, this very moment, is something that is very, very, very critical. Not only is it critical, but listen to me, it's very significant. And what I mean by that is the number one question that comes to all of our minds is how do I get there? Where will it be? What's the next step? We're always thinking ahead and trying to be able to get ahead of time, if you will. And we forget about the importance of time. One man said this, he talked about the words. I think it was a great riddle, and I can't remember exactly how it went, but I remember one time, what is something that you can spend that you never get back? And of course, the first thing that comes to a lot of our minds is money. We think that when we spend it, we can't ever get it back, and that's normally the number one answer that comes to that question. But they also talk about words. Whenever you speak a word and that word comes off of your lips, that you'll never have the opportunity to be able to take that word back. Once you say something, if it's a word that cuts deep and it cuts somebody to the core, if it's a word that is an aimless word or a word that is vain, if you will, if it's a word that has no use, you can never go back and re-speak that word again. Once it's out, it's out. There's no way back. But he also said the importance of time. Understanding that time is something that once you spend that moment, listen to me, you'll never be able to spend that moment again. So many people want to talk about what they're going to be next year and next week and when I get here and when I get married and when I get a job and when I get to dating and when I get my ministry and when I get a pulpit and when I get a wife and when I get a husband and when I get this and when and when and when. And listen, we forget about the here and the now. We forget about what we can do right now, and we spend so much time trying to understand and plan for the future that we simply get to a place that we forget about the present. Don't ever get to the place where you think so much about the future, and it's okay to think about the future. It's okay to plan for the future, but don't ever be so blinded by trying to plan for the future and wait for the future when you forget to do what you're supposed to do in the present. We always think that there's something we're trying to get to, when the truth be told is you can control tomorrow by living the way you're supposed to live with God today. Don't ever forget that. Quit coming to church and thinking church is going to fix us. This world, that's all they think. Church will eventually, when I quit drinking, I'll get saved. When I quit doing this sin, I'll get saved. When I calm down, I'll get saved. When I stop doing this, I'll start serving. When I get this right, I'll get back where I need it. No, you need to do it now. Why? Because God's already been faithful. So many times we find out that we're so busy trying to look ahead that we forget about what we need to do now. Genesis chapter number 5 is known as the genealogy. One of the greatest genealogies in the Bible is found in 1 Chronicles chapter number 7 to me. It's probably been the greatest impact in my life as a biblical man, learning a biblical man. I say that for this reason, because I think that there's a great importance in genealogies. You want to know why? Because God said so. He said all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and it's profitable. And I want you to hear me when I said that. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable. So there is no such thing as getting through a certain text and thinking, I don't need this. This ain't for me. It's boring. I promise you, you look long enough, you'll learn something and the Holy Ghost will teach you something. You believe that? Say amen. Here in this text, I want you to notice what the Bible says. 10 men. There's one that I'm interested in, but we're going to start reading in verse number 21. And Enoch lived 65 years. And begat Methuselah. And Enoch walked with God after he begat Methuselah 300 years and begat sons and daughters. And all the days of Enoch were 365 years. And Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for he took him. I want you to notice what the Bible says in verse number 22, where the Bible says this, and Enoch walked with God. In verse number 24, where the Bible says, and Enoch walked with God. I want to think about this thought tonight, what it means to walk with God. Here in this text, there's 10 men, but there's only one man that you see that the Bible says the Lord had actually taken him. Now, this man stands above the other men, and we're going to break it down here in a few moments. But it was not because of his family. It was not because of his position. It was not because of his title. It was not because of his possessions. It wasn't because, listen, I'm not trying to preach. I'm trying to help you understand this. That literally, that it wasn't because of what he had. It wasn't because of his success that the world saw. It wasn't because of what the people's perception was of him. It wasn't because of where he had actually arrived in life. That wasn't the thing that made Enoch so special and stand above everybody else. The Bible says that literally that he had walked with God. And the Bible says that he was one of two men in the Bible that the Lord decided to be able to take. Now, what's amazing to me is this, is that we all want to live like him. We want to have that privilege to be able to be taken. Now listen, I know those of us that are saved, we understand, as one man said, that death is the front porch to the house that we're going to live in for eternity. In other words, you and I being saved by the grace of God, we should not fear death. We should not worry about death. We should not be overwhelmed by death. Why? Because death will actually take us from where we are to eternity. And all God's people said, amen. We're longing for that. Thank God for that. But the truth be told, if we could, we would love just to walk with God and just all of a sudden the Lord just take us home. One old man said it this way. He was an old preacher that I had read in a book one time. He said this. He said, I believe that Enoch could walk with him so much that they got so far walking together. He just looked at Enoch and said, hey, Enoch, we're closer to my house now than we are yours. Won't you just go home with me? Amen. Now, I say that because he walked with God for a long time. Now, we know that's not the truth. But the point is this. Many of us want the latter part of Enoch's life. Many of us want to be taken home. Many of us just want to be able to rejoice and be gone. But there's very few of us that will actually do what the Bible says that he does first. We want the end, but we don't want the beginning. We want to be taken, but we don't want to walk. We want the Lord to bring us home, but yet we don't want to fellowship with him. And what I'm trying to tell you tonight is this. Don't get so caught up in what you want to be and what you think you need to be and where you're going, but make your mind up that I know where I am and I know whom I believe. And if my faith and salvation is in the Lord Jesus Christ, then I'm going to make my mind up to walk with him every single day of my life. The Bible says that Enoch had made his mind up that I'm going to live for God, because he understands this one principle, that this man cared more about the journey than he did the destination. And I want to say this to you as a child of God. We got to understand that the journey matters. The journey matters. How you live on this side of heaven, it matters. It matters to God. It matters to the kingdom of God. It matters for the testimony. It matters how you live on this side of heaven. We got to quit living for a destination and understand that Christ lives inside of us. Understand that I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. You can. Stop letting the devil make excuses and tell you that you can't. You can, but you got to start now. And what it boils down to is this, is who are you yielding to? Who are you listening to? Who are you following after? Are you following after the world? Are you following after the lust? Are you following after your flesh? Are you following after yourself? Are you following after somebody else? Are you listening to the Lord Jesus Christ and walking after him? As the Bible says, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. Hey, thank God that we can trust God to be able to take us where we need to go on this journey. Amen. I want to ask you this question. How's the journey? Amen. How's the journey? I know where you're going if you're saved, but how's your journey? I'm beat up, preacher, so was Job. I'm lonely and mocked, preacher, so was Noah. I messed up, preacher, so did Moses and so did David. There's a lot of excuses that we use on a daily basis. But how is the journey? I mean, you got to think about that. God has got a plan and got a purpose for the here and now. Every day you wake up, you got to make your mind up. I die daily. I die to my flesh. I put on the armor of God. I put on the protection to be able to control my mind, to be able to live right before God. Realize it's not my righteousness, but it's his righteousness. I ain't nothing I've ever earned or I've ever merited. It's only by the good grace of Almighty God. And realize that God has called you. And if God has called you, then God will equip you. And if God will equip you, then the Bible says he will finish with you. you the work which he hath begun. I'm glad to know that what you and I are doing tonight ain't based upon my knowledge, ain't based upon my strength, ain't based upon what I can do, but Jesus Christ has already won the battle. Thank God for the victory in the Lord Jesus Christ. But we don't live that way. We don't live that way. And this man was a dynamic man. In 1189 chapters in the Bible, only 10 verses actually talk about this man by the name of Enoch. And you think, how in the world could God use somebody? Here's the point. There's a lot of people might not say a lot about you, but it's what God thinks about you. Huh? Here's another point. Quit trying to please everybody else and just please Jesus. Here's another point. Quit worrying about what everybody else thinks and just ask him what he thinks. Quit worrying about trying to fix everything that you need to be fixed and just make sure everything's fixed between you and him. Somebody say amen. We got to live for the now and understand that God has got a purpose for what he's doing. So notice, if you will, in verses number 22 and 24. The Bible says Enoch walked with God. Now here's why that amazes me. You're talking about the same God that he said, let there be light, and there was light. Now here's what's so amazing. How in the world did a man that lived in the flesh, how in the world did he live such a way that God would walk with him? I want to go a step further, and I can prove this biblically, but I got to say it now because we're in the New Testament, because you got to understand who you are as the devil fights you. See, the devil already understands about the death, burial, and the resurrection. He understands that everything is taken care of, and the truth be told, he has absolutely no authority. He understands that. And that's because you and I look back to the cross. Now listen, I got to say this because this might be teaching, but you got to understand. They live by faith. We live by grace. Are you with me tonight? And what that tells me is this. If God will walk with somebody that lived by faith, and those of us that are saved, the Holy Ghost lives inside of us, then you tell me why we can't have access to God walking with us if Jesus Christ lives inside of us. We've got this mindset that we can't walk with God. No, we probably hold hands with God, and God probably stops before we take him in some places. Now, I agree with that. Huh? We probably get in the car, turn on the radio, and he jumps out while the car is moving. Somebody say amen. 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 We want to walk with God. We want all the goodness of God. We want all the mercy of God, but we don't want the first part. I want to give you three principles tonight. Number one, walking with God sets us apart from others. Walking with God sets us apart from others. It's obvious that if you're going to walk with God, that many of us think that we want to be able to set apart. I mean, let's just be honest. Somebody that gets up and grabs a microphone and begins to sing a song, truth be told, even though they have talent, you can usually discern or determine whether or not they've been walking with God. You can tell by a preacher sometimes by the way that he gets up whether the power of God is on his life. You can tell by a saint of God when they get up and testify whether or not they've been walking with God. You can talk to somebody that's been doing something for the Lord and you can tell if they've been walking with God. Why? Because you can manufacture a lot of things and you can sing a lot of good songs and you can outline a lot of good messages and you can shake a lot of hands at a lot of doors. But there's one thing that you cannot make up, and that is the power of God in your life. If we would get a hunger for the power of God, for God to be able to use us, where we would not just make an influence but make an impact and be effective in this world, just think what God could do with our life. And it is distinctively different. Somebody that's living a victorious life and somebody just knows they're saved. But you notice these things, if you will, tonight. These 10 men in this chapter, the Bible says in verse number 5, Verse number 3 introduces Adam. And Adam lived. Verse number 5, and listen to this. And he died. Seth in verse number 6. And Seth lived. Verse number 8, and he died. Enos, verse number 9. Verse number 11, notice again. And he died. Verse number 12, Canaan, I believe is how you say it, said that he had lived. The Bible says in verse number 14, and he died. Verse number 15, my Lord, no, I didn't practice how to say this 15 times before I started preaching. Mahalalalalala. And I'm not speaking in tongues, amen. In verse number 15, and verse number 17, it says, and he died. Verse number 18, the Bible says, and Jared lived. Verse number 20, the Bible says, and he died. But then, in the middle of this, the Bible says in verse number 21, and Enoch lived. In verse number 25, the Bible says, all of a sudden, for God took him. He disrupts everything. Everybody else died. But this man, the Lord took him. Now I want you to keep going further. His son, Methuselah, lived. Verse number 25, and the Bible says, verse 27, and he died. Lamech, verse number 28, and he lived. Verse number 31, and he died. Verse number 32, Noah, and you understand the text by reading it, says that he had lived, and then the flood comes, but after the flood, and he died. I say all of that because there is something distinctively different about this man by the name of Enoch. He was set apart from all the other 10 men that is talked about in his genealogy. Now, here's what's amazing to me. The Bible says, thinking about the first man being Adam, he was the first. He had to be outstanding. Why? Because he was first. So I say that for this reason. There's an accomplishment about this man. There's something distinct about this man. There's something good about this man. The Bible says that Methuselah lived 969 years old. How many of you know that's a long time? But I would dare say that's a lot to talk about a man that's lived 969 years old. The Bible says that Noah literally had saved the human race. These men were outstanding. Are you understanding me? They were outstanding. There was something that was amazing about their life. There was something that you could talk about. He's the first man. This is the oldest man. This is the man that saved the human race itself. There's a lot of great things. These are absolutely outstanding men. But then there's ordinary men. Seth. He's an ordinary man. Enos, he's an ordinary man. Jared, he's an ordinary man. Listen to me. Most people think there's ordinary and outstanding in life. Truth be told, I want to say this to you. A lot of us live just to be outstanding. I want to be an outstanding husband. I want to be an outstanding wife. I want to be an outstanding pastor. I want to be an outstanding Christian. I want to be set apart. Now, let me put it in there. He said, I don't want to be outstanding. I'm humble. Okay, well then, listen to me, Mr. and Mrs. Humble. I want to make it. I don't want to quit. Why? Because you want to be able to say you went through some things and by God's grace you made it. Thank God for it. There's nothing wrong with being outstanding. Can I get an amen? But just because you're outstanding don't mean you walked with God. Because if that was the case, he'd have said the same thing about Adam. He'd have said the same thing about Methuselah. And he'd have said the same thing about Noah. And I want to tell you tonight that if you want to be different and you want God to touch you, then walking with God is the absolute greatest thing that you can make your mind up that you want to do every single day. That's the simple but yet deepest point I could possibly tell you, that walking with God will separate you. Walking with God will change you. Walking with God is greater than somebody that lives for a long time. One man said this, it's not about It's not about how long you live. It's about how you live the life that you've been given. Walking with God is greater than speech. There's a lot of people that can say a lot of good things. Do you know that nowhere in the text, one word is recorded from Enoch? Not one word. Do you know how long we've been talking about this man and he never spoke a word? It's fair to say it's not about what you say, it's how you live. One man said this, it's better to be considered a fool than to open your mouth and take away all doubt. Huh? Sometimes we need to learn to just keep our mouth shut. Can I get an amen? Walking with God is not only greater than how long you live and how well you speak, but walking with God is greater than your accomplishments. If you turn back to chapter number 4, verse number 17, I want you to notice what the Bible says. And Cain knew his wife, and she conceived, and bare who? Everybody say Enoch. Now here's the deal. This ain't the same man. This is a different man. But if you notice in that same verse, notice what the Bible says. The Bible says, and he builded a city and called the name of the city after the name of his son, Enoch. Listen to me. Walking with God is more important than your accomplishments, and here's why. One man had a city named after him and had less said about him, but another man just simply walked with God, and we're still talking about him today. Quit chasing fame and recognition. Quit chasing the who's who and the credibility of somebody else patting you on the back. Quit asking everybody to approve of your actions and just get up and make your mind up, I just want God to approve of what I do. A lot of times we want people to approve of it so we can get another place to serve or another place to preach or another opportunity to teach somewhere. Amen, I'm telling it right. We want to be trusted with God's work. Now let me say, you want to be trusted with God's work, then get God to trust you. A lot of people always want to, Brother Jason don't want nobody to know. Some people don't even show up for church. No, they're not even faithful to God. So what if somebody's not faithful to God, what makes you think they're going to be faithful to the ministry? I mean, it's old and listen, I'm not talking about the new crowd. I'm talking about the old Haynes crowd. There's been people for hundreds and hundreds of years that have thought that because of who they are and what they own and how long they've been around, that they deserve something. No, if we deserve something, it's only by the grace of God, and it's because we walk with God. Everybody wants the latter, but they don't want the first. Number two, walking with God not only separates us from others, but walking with God brings you into the presence of God. What do you mean by that, Brother Jason? We understand walking with God for him literally took him into the presence of God to be absent from the bodies, to be present with the Lord. We understand the Lord just took him up. We understand that if we die, we will be present with the Lord. But that's not what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about is that we actually can be in the presence of God before we ever face death. See, the Bible says in Genesis chapter number 3, the Bible says that they were walking in the garden. And the Bible says that literally that the voice of God, in verse number 8, walking. It didn't say the voice of God talking. It said the voice of God walking. You know what that means? That the voice of God was actually looking out. It was searching. It was on the move, if you will. Why? Because it was the voice of God that was trying to get out. And listen, the Garden of Eden was symbolic of the presence of God. So here's the point. When you walk with God, you stay in the presence of God. We always say, well, I don't feel God. Listen, don't get a preacher to answer this question. Don't need a sermon to be able to get this. Think about it logically, realistically. Just think about the simplicity of it, if you will. If you don't feel God's presence, are you really walk with God? Now, you look good on the outside. You singing in the choir. You coming to church. And you make it on Sunday morning. You probably even go to Sunday school and everything's good. But you're still wondering, why don't I feel God's presence? So my question is this. Are you walking with Him? Are you walking with Him? It was in the Garden of Eden where they sinned, and God had to say, Adam, where art thou? He got out of the presence of God. Why? Because God can't have sin in His presence. Are y'all with me? Walking with God keeps you in the presence of God. Walking with God keeps you in the presence of God. It's not study. It's not singing. It's not devotion. The way you walk with God is having fellowship, walking with the Lord day to day. The Bible says in Amos 3:3, can two walk together except they be agreed? And so that means you and us walk together. But that's the same thing with God. You think God, if He don't agree with us, is He going to contradict His word? Absolutely not. If we want fellowship with God, I mean, we got to walk and we got to agree. He's got to agree with what we do, what we say, how we act, how we think, our motives. He's not going to be part of any of that mess. Presence of God, let's be honest. We want our burdens removed. We want our brokenness removed. We want our disheartened and downhearted lives changed. And sometimes they are not always changed. But I will say this, in the presence of God, you'll find more strength in the middle of your heartache than being exempt from what you should be facing without God's presence. It's okay to be broken in God's presence. But don't be stubborn and think you've succeeded by getting out. Listen, by getting out of what God put you in to change you and mold you. Do you notice all the way through the text? Listen. Nowhere in the Bible did I find that Enoch ever built an altar. You know why? Because an altar was a direct access to be able to get to God. That's how they got. They had sacrifice. He walked with God. Why did he need an altar? I'm just saying. It's everybody with me? Miss Deborah, you come. Last point. Walking with God begins in your own heart. And I'm done. Verse number 22. The Bible says, and Enoch walked with God after he begat Methuselah. You know, when I first got saved, I was waiting on God, listen, to move in my life, to help me serve, to put me in a place. I was waiting on God to answer prayer. Now that I pastor, you know the number one question I always hear? When's God going to show up, Brother Jason? When's God going to deliver me from this? When's God going to show up and do something? When? You know what Enoch teaches us? The importance of making a decision. You know why? Because he didn't have to wait on God. He made his mind up, I'm going to walk with God no matter what happens. And when he's ready to tell me, I'll be close enough to hear his voice. You hear me? You have to make a decision to walk with God. Notice the Bible says, after Methuselah. That means it was 65 years he lived his life after Methuselah. 65 years after Methuselah. Notice, he walked with God. Here's what that means. Before he was 65 years old, he was ordinary. He might have even been outstanding. I don't know. The Bible don't say. But the Bible says after 65 years, he walked with God. Y'all see, it's in the text. Y'all see that? If you don't see it, you missed the whole point. It starts in your heart. Because see, when he had a child, I don't know how many of y'all has ever done this, but God ever gave you a kid, and all of a sudden you look at your kids and you're like, it's time for me to get serious for serving God. That's what the Bible says right there. But here's what I got out of that. It's never too late to make a decision to start walking with God. I don't care how you lived the last 65 years of your life. Listen to me. Start today. Quit when I get here, when this happens. Quit thinking about when this happened. Make your mind up today. Today. Quit putting it off. Quit putting it off for this to happen or that to bring up or for this circumstance to work out or this circumstance. No, what you're doing is you're trying to make God do it your way. Quit being hard-headed and giving all kinds of excuses and different things and realize it's your choice to make up your mind right now. Walk with God. Walk with God. You want a victorious life? Make your mind up.
As the pastor, I want to thank you for viewing our video today. However, if God's dealt with your heart, we do not want to end this video without giving you a chance to be able to accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior. If you're there today and God's actually dealing with your heart, I want to remind you what the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That means every single one of us has had problems, issues, sin, failures, faults in our past. But the great thing is this, is that Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh through the Father but by me. There is a way to be able to have hope, to have eternal security within the Lord Jesus Christ, to be able to know that you're saved by the grace of God. Now, the great thing about the Bible is it tells us about the love of God. He says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth Him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And that's amazing to a lot of people, and they can quote it. But the beauty of it is this, is the very next verse tells us the purpose of Christ. Because the Bible says, for God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, that the world through Him might be saved. That means that God sent His Son to die for those of us who are sinners so that we can have fellowship with God Himself. Now, if you're there today and God's really been dealing with your heart, I want to ask you this question. Do you really believe that God's been dealing with you about salvation? If that's the case today, then I want to tell you what you need to do is repent of your sins. You need to die to yourself. Admit that you're lost and you're on your way to hell. And then look at what the Bible tells us, that He tells us that we can be saved through Christ. Who do you call on? There's only one. As the Bible says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. It's only through Christ and Christ alone. So I tell you today, would you trust in Christ? When I ask you, would you trust in Him as a personal Savior? You say, Brother Jason, I don't really know if I can do that. Well, let me tell you, the Bible also tells us that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It don't matter who you are, where you come from. God sent His Son to die for everyone. If you've made this decision today to be able to trust in Christ, to be able to die to yourself, to be able to start living for Christ and accept Him as a personal Savior after repenting, would you do us a favor and be able to contact us at 336-788-0551 and let us know about this decision that you made so we can start praying for you. Thank you so much.